Yeah, what I'm going to show you today is contained in another Python notebook that you can already find on your respective course pages down here. And in this, we are going back to this XOR problem that Professor Stein already showed today. This is where I wanted to go. So we saw that a single perceptron cannot solve this, a multi-layer perceptron can. And we will look at how to actually implement this and learn the perceptron model in a simple Python program. So we want to implement the multi-layer perceptron in plain NumPy. So first of all, this was the data set from the slides, right? So four examples with two attributes. I've defined this as a simple matrix here. So this first column will be x1, the second column will be x2. And then this one-dimensional vector will be the corresponding values of the class attributes. So you can quickly check this by hand that this is correct, right? We have 0, x or 0 equals 0. The second element, 0, x or 1 equals 1. 1, x or 0 equals 1. And 1, x or 1 equals 0 again. So this will be our entire data set for this exercise. So the first thing that we are going to do is put this attribute x0 in front of it that we always use to represent the bias parameter. So we just put a column of ones in front of it. And here I've done this using the column stack function from NumPy, which takes a list of arrays and then puts them behind each other as columns. The first column then should be the vector of ones here that comes out of the np.ones function. I think we've seen this also before already, right? So if you give this some number, then it just produces a one-dimensional array with this amount of ones in it. If you give it a shape, so for example, something like this, you can also construct matrices or even higher order tensors filled with all ones if that's what you want. And here we just put this column in front of our axis. A thing I would like to point out in this place is that everywhere on the slides where you see reference to some vector by name, here for example, this x. When it's written like this, we always mean a column vector because that is just the standard way to do it in mathematics. And if we refer to a row vector, we write it as the transpose. When we read a data set, we usually get it kind of as a table. So actually a row corresponds to a single example and a column corresponds to all the attributes across this attribute across all examples. But in this implementation, I'm also going to treat the examples as column vectors to better match the slides. So that means this matrix, we would actually have to transpose it to work this way. So then our four columns of axis would look like this. But this row-wise table function is how you'd normally get the data, and it has also the sometimes desirable property that you can easier extract a single example. So the first element of this row-wise matrix is the first example with the transpose. This is more complicated, but this just as a clarification. So we want to define a multi-layer perceptron. No, this is too far back. To solve the XOR problem, kind of like this. We're not going to use the step function as threshold function because as you know, this is not differentiable and cannot be learned. So we'll use the sigmoid function right away. Otherwise, it will look like this. So we have these three input units. We will have two hidden units plus this bias and a single output unit. And for this, I'm just going to write down the parameters here. So P will be the number of attributes in our feature space, or the number of in our input space, sorry, or the number of input units excluding the constant term. L will be the number of hidden units, and K will be the number of output units. So this these three values together define what our parameter matrices look like. So we saw this on the slides also. We have the matrix WH, which takes us from input space into the hidden layer feature space. And this has the shape L times P plus 1, P plus 1 because of this bias attribute here. And then we have the matrix WO, which takes us from the hidden layer feature space to the output space. And this has the shape K times L plus 1. So in this case, 1 times 3. And then we will, from here, just step by step walk through this algorithm. And the first thing that we need to do is initialize our parameter matrices with random values. For that, we can use the random.normal function to use normally distributed random values. As an aside, there have been possibly hundreds of papers written about how to properly initialize the weights in neural networks. So this is a very simple thing that I'm doing here. This can be there has been a lot of thought on how to do this, but we'll not get into this any deeper. I'm only specifying here the size parameter, which determines the dimensions of the matrix of random values that we're going to get. I'm leaving the mean and standard deviation of this normal distribution at their defaults, which are 0 and 1 respectively. So then we already have our initialization for the matrices WH and WO given like this. Then we can also look at what they look like. So we have, as we should, this 2x3 matrix for WH. This is the first one here. And this 1x3 matrix for WO, which is the second one here. The next thing we are going to need is to define the threshold function. Like I said, we're going to use the sigmoid. And I'm just going to write this as a single line lambda expression here. So 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power of negative, the argument of the sigmoid function. To remind you what this looks like, I've plotted it also here again real quick. So at if this input is 0, then we get 0.5. As this goes to negative infinity, we approach 0. And as this goes to positive infinity, we approach 1. And that's the sigmoid function. So now the next thing we want to do is compute the forward path of our neural network. We also had this on this slide, for example. So we can write down this entire two-layer neural network as a rather simple formula, which is the sigmoid function applied to the WO matrix multiplied with this common vector of 1, and the sigmoid function applied again to the WH matrix multiplied with the vector x. And we're going to do this for a single example, as in the incremental gradient descent algorithm. So I'm just going to take out the first value of the data set here, the first x. So this is the vector 1 for x0 and 0 for x1 and x2. This is our example that we are going to work with through here. And like I mentioned, we want to implement this all for column vectors. So I'm going to turn this into a column vector. There are multiple ways to do this in NumPy. A simple way is to use the reshape function, which takes as an argument the new shape that you want. And in this new shape, you can put -1 as a special argument. That means that NumPy is supposed to figure out the correct number of elements along this dimension. So what I'm by putting -1, 1 here as the shape. I'm saying I definitely want one column in the result and however many rows to make this match this X that I used as input. So I can use this exact same call even if I had thousands of attributes, and I don't even need to know how many exactly there are. I will always get a column vector as a result. Okay, so then the first step of our forward pass is this in here, multiplying our hidden layer weight matrix with the X. This uses the normal matrix multiplication operator, or this add that you have seen before in previous tutorials. And so here's the WH again, here's the X that we are putting into this, and this is the result of the multiplication. So we are multiplying a 3x2 matrix with what we now consider as a 3x1 matrix, right? So that means the dimensions of our result have to be 2x1. Oh, and this is 2x3. I think I said it the wrong way around. And then, yeah, this value here is the same as this value, of course, because the second argument has a 1 here and a 0 everywhere else. So we add 1 times this plus 0 times this plus 0 times this to get this value of the result. And same for the second element of the result of this multiplication. So that means this part is now done. Next, we apply the sigmoid function to this. And the way we've defined it here, we can simply call this function from above, and then it's applied element wise to every element of this vector separately. And I've put the product again here between the brackets, so we don't have to define an extra variable for that. And this gives us the expected result, right? So we had an array of two values that are positive, so we should get two values that are greater than 0.5, and the bigger value is a bit closer to 1, so this looks reasonable if you look at this curve. Okay, and next comes this step of making our vector YH, which is the hidden layer activation, as it's commonly called. And that means, in our case, stacking a 1 on top of this common vector that we get as the result of the matrix multiplication. This is using this bias unit here. This comes into play now. So we add this YH0 equals 1. And for that, we can simply use the row stack function. And since we are only stacking a single value, I can also only specify a single value here. And then this is our YH that we get as a result. And after that, computing the final output of the network is simply another matrix multiplication, this time with the output layer weights, and then applying the sigmoid function to the result. And this looks as you might expect. So from this, we now get a, it's actually a 1x1 matrix, but you could also say it's simply a scalar, because WO is 1x3 and YH is 3x1. So of course, the result of this matrix multiplication will be 1x1. And after we apply the sigmoid function to that, we get 0.69 as the network output for this training example of both zeros. And that completes the forward pass through the network. So now to what we want to do next is figure out how wrong we were, and then based on that, update the parameters of the network, right? So we said we were going to use this, here it is, this squared loss function. So we could just plug this value in there, right? So that would mean we can compute the difference between y and the class. Oh, I think I called this that. Yeah, the difference between y and the class value of the first example, which is zero. If we go back to the data set that this one. So the difference, of course, is also zero, and then we would square that. And this would be our error for these for this single example. And by the way, this square is also applied element wise. So if you are in a situation, let's quickly, as an aside, define something where you have multiple values. Okay, and let's say they are between zero and one. So we are and let's say the, we had k equals 3 now in a different universe, and these were our network outputs, and the actual true class value for this would have been 1 for the first class and 0 for the other two. Then we could still do the same thing. We do the subtraction, and that is element wise. So we get for every matching pair of elements of these two vectors, we get a vector with the differences. So here 0.8 minus 1 is negative 0.2, and so on. And we can also square this element wise using these exact same syntax. And then this would give us the value of the error function. Okay, but the thing is, we actually don't want exactly the value of the error function to update our weights, but we want the derivative of that with respect of with respect to the individual components of the weight vector. And as mentioned previously, we will skip the full derivation of this for now. I'm just going to take the values that we have provided on the slide and use these here, but walk you through how the syntax for that looks. So essentially what we do, as mentioned previously in the lecture, we derive this loss function once with respect to the output layer weights and once with respect to the input layer weights. And that gives us two matrices that tell us the gradient for each individual parameter in the network. That eventually then tells us how to update these parameters. That's where this learning rate then also comes into play. Okay, so that means we, of course, need the class value of the first example. And this difference without the square, this is a term in the derivative of that. That is what you see here. So we just compute this. And yeah, right. This I've already explained, but when you go through the notebook again by yourself later, you can also see here again how the multiplication, subtraction, and so on, the normal operators are applied element-wise. So for these two matrices here, you see that in the result, whenever there is a zero in one of the two, then we get a zero in the result. So yeah. And yeah, the key thing we first need to compute is this value delta O, which is the this is part of the derivative of the error with respect to the output layer weights. For the full derivative, we still need to multiply this by h, but we will do this separately because we need this value again later. So we compute delta O, which is the difference in from of the network output to the class value, multiplied element wise with the network output, and 1 minus the network output. By the way, this why this is here, this is hopefully clear to you, because well, what is y? Y is a sigmoid function at the outermost layer, right? And we have learned in the previous lab class already that the derivative of the sigmoid function is sigmoid times 1 minus sigmoid. And so this is what you get essentially when you apply the chain rule to derive this entire expression. And that is that bit of the derivative. Okay, so we've computed this value now. And we need this again to find the derivative of the error with respect to the hidden layer weights. This appears again here. And so I will just plug all these values in. Perhaps the first slightly complicated thing that we are doing is this term here in the front, which uses the transpose of the output layer weight matrix. You can think of this as when we are going in the forward direction, we use the weight matrix as it is to project from this feature space to this output space. And when we want to move the gradient backwards, we use the transpose to do the inverse of this projection. So to take the error that we get at the output layer here and move that to the hidden layer, we use the transpose of the output weights. And that's what happens in this first line. So in this case, this gives us a 3x1 matrix, because we had delta O as 1x1, and this output layer matrix, where is it? One second. Here. Is 1x3. When we transpose it, it's 3x1. So we have 3x1 times 1x1, and this gives us a 3x1 result. That's the first output you see here. The next thing is we compute this delta H. So we use this projection and multiply it with another part of the derivative of the error function, this time of the derivative with respect to the hidden layer matrix, and that's where yh times 1 minus yh appears. Again, why this is there follows from the fact that yh is, for the most part, an application of the sigmoid function. One peculiarity here is the fact that we have introduced this this artificial kind of value 1 here. So from here on, there is no gradient to propagate backwards to the input layer. So that means the first component of this delta H, as we've computed it up to here, will always be 0, and there will be nowhere to use it further up in the network. So we will just get rid of it and take as our final delta H a vector, in this case of 2, that has the same number of elements as there are hidden units here, excluding this bias unit. And with that, we continue. We have now both delta O and delta H computed. So we can now figure out the gradient relevant to both of our weight matrices and update them. We see here this term eta, which is just a small positive constant with which the gradient is multiplied. For here, I'm just going to use the value 1. So things stay simple. Usually you would use a smaller value, but that is something you might need to tweak and evaluate based on the particular data set and how many parameters the model has. So we now come to this dyadic product that has been pointed out already. This turns a pair of vectors into a matrix. We do this to map the gradient to the respective space that matches the weight matrices. So we have for WO, we have a 1x3 matrix. And for delta O, we have a 1x1. So we multiply this with YH, which is 3x1, to get a 1x3 result. And for this dyadic product, you also use the normal matrix multiplication operator from NumPy, because that is essentially what it is. So I've shown this here again. This is the 1x1 times that's this, and times 1x3, which is this. And that gives you another 1x3. And that is going to match the WO matrix then. So the final thing left to do now is to multiply this with the learning rate. Since we used the value 1, this doesn't change anything, to get our value delta WO and add this onto the current parameter matrix. And as you see here, again, this is done element-wise. So we get in this delta WO, we get an individual update for each component of the parameter matrix as far as it contributed to the current error that we've seen. And we do the update for all parameters in one step, essentially, with the help of NumPy. So that means from the point of view of the algorithm, we have done line 9 and already line 11 as well, and 10 and 12 are still missing. And they are essentially the same, but we have now updated this matrix here, and we still want to update this matrix. But as far as we've come now, this is fairly straightforward. We need the X to get the full gradient for this hidden layer weights. And again, we multiply our delta H, which was a 2x1 in this case, with X, which is a 3x1. And that gives us the 2x3 that we need to update the WH matrix. And then finally, again, we update component wise. You see here that most of the components of WH are not updated. That makes sense when you look at the example X that we actually used, which has zero values in the attributes in both of them. And that is why it is like this now. So these parameters, actually, these parameters of WH, these four here that correspond to the attributes X1 and X2, they didn't actually do anything in this path, and therefore they also don't get updated. And yeah, that's basically it. This we just do for each training example, and then repeat this whole process multiple times for a number of iterations, or until some convergence criterion is satisfied. And then we have learned the parameters for a multilayer perceptron that solves, in this case, the XOR problem. The final thing I'm going to show you here is how to put this all together in a simple multilayer or two-layer perceptron, in this case, implementation that kind of matches the scikit-learn conventions. So we have a class with a constructor that sets up the hyperparameters for the model. We have a function predict that takes an example and gives us the model prediction, and a function fit that implements this learning algorithm that we just stepped through. A few specialties here. So in the constructor of actually already constructing the parameter matrices and reserving memory for it in the correct shape. And then later I'm overwriting them again with random values when we do the actual learning algorithm. But you don't have to implement it this way. The predict function I have written so that it assumes that X is already a column vector. So that means when we call it, we have to take care of that. And this otherwise does the normal forward pass, computes YH, And this is actually not really YH yet. Only once we append the ones here, I've written this slightly more complicated expression here that gives us the ones in the correct shape, because maybe we didn't put in a single X, but a whole matrix with the entire data set that this function should also support. And this modification here takes care of that. And at the end, we are using actually the Heaviside function to turn this real value that our network gives us after the sigmoid function, which is some value between 0 and 1, but that is not actually either 0 or 1. And we want to turn this, and this then very much depends on the particular classification problem. In this case, we were working in a setting where our classes are either 0 or 1. So I'm using the Heaviside function to turn this real value here into either 0 or 1 by using 0.5 as threshold. And this second parameter that the Heaviside takes tells it what to do when we get exactly 0.5. I've decided to use 0 then, but then we could have also flipped a coin or something. But anyway, what we want here is the call to predict to give us either 0 or 1 for each example and nothing in between. The fit function just includes everything we walked through previously. Another thing I'm showcasing here is this TQDM. This comes from a library that you will also find installed in the notebooks that you can use on our cluster, or that you can run a Docker on your local machine. This is a library that gives you progress bars in a very simple and user-friendly way. So if you're using them, using this in a notebook, you just import the single function TQDM, which is in a package called TQDM.notebook, or a module rather. And then you put it in a for loop like this. So whatever this for loop is iterating over, you wrap the TQDM function call around it, and it still iterates over the same thing, but at the same time, while doing so, it shows you a progress bar that also tells you how long this iteration is probably going to take, which when you experiment with this model and with more complicated data sets, as we might ask you to do in the next exercise sheet, this will come in handy. So otherwise, you might wonder whether your program has crashed or what is going on. But anyway, otherwise you will find this is the algorithm exactly as it is written on the slide. So we have an outer loop that iterates, that basically just increases this value t from using the Python built-in range function starting from 0 to this parameter self.tmax that we have specified on the constructor. I've given a default value of 1000, but yeah, when you construct this class, you can change it. So we, by default, do 1,000 iterations of this outer loop, and we show a progress bar that tells us how many of these we have finished. And then we go to the inner loop that is implemented exactly like this one. So we take the examples X and their class values individually from the data set that is passed in here. So here we have the X's and the classes separately, but with this zip function, we get each pair of X and its corresponding class value. And that is what this X and CX then is. One thing we have to do differently here is to make sure that X is a column vector, because if I use this data set as I had defined it up here, we have the X is still as rows. Oh, that was wrong. Okay, back. And otherwise, we do exactly what I just showed you for a single example. So all of the lines in the algorithm you will find also in this implementation here. And yeah, that's it. Let's run this real quick. So this P, L, and K, as I defined it up there, this was two, and this was one. And then we are going to fit this to the entire XOR data set. And this is the result of this TQDM function. We could also decide that we want to run this for a couple more iterations, maybe 10,000 Java, but then you see this is already starting to come in handy, because otherwise you might be wondering why you are waiting so long. But here we even see after this less than sign an estimate for how long this is going to take. In the last line here, I called the predict function using the entire data set as input. So access.t looks like this. Like I told you earlier, we have one column, for example, now. And this then gives us all the predictions for the examples in this data set in the single array as output. And we see that we actually solved this problem correctly with this perceptron. So that would have been something that didn't work if we start from random values or from from all parameters as zero. We would also, the way it is implemented now, predict everything as zero. So the learning would actually be necessary for this to work. And ultimately, we can inspect the weight matrices that this learning process came up with. And if you want, you can try to follow along by hand here, like we have shown in the slides also. So it might be that what this network learned is not exactly like this. There might be different separating planes that it uses to turn this problem into a problem that at the final layer is linearly separable. So it might be quite instructive to take these values, plug them in here, and then walk through this example by hand and see what the network actually learned, as opposed to the example here that we constructed manually. Okay, that's it for this. As a reminder, you can find this notebook on the course webpage and follow along and experiment with it. And we might also ask you to use it as a starting point for the next exercise. And if there are any questions now, please let me know.